Hey, this is Mr. W. This cup has little spinach leaf discs on the bottom. These discs are in the light and they're doing photosynthesis, which produces oxygen gas, which causes these discs to float up to the surface. It's what happens in the light reactions of photosynthesis, which is what we're going to explain in this video. This video is connected to a series of interactive tutorials on my website, sciencemusicvideos.com, which you can access through a free trial subscription. Photosynthesis occurs in plant cells in organelles called chloroplasts. The inner fluid of the chloroplast is called the stroma. It's equivalent to the cytosol of a eukaryotic cell. The stroma surrounds these little membrane-bound sacs called thylakoids, which are organized into stacks called grana. Within chloroplasts, photosynthesis occurs in two stages, the first of which is the light reactions. These reactions occur in the thylakoids, which take water and light energy and use them to accomplish two things, making ATP and reducing a molecule called NADP plus into NADPH. The ATP plays the role it always does. It drives an endergonic or energy-requiring process. In this case, it's driving forward the second phase of photosynthesis, the Calvin cycle. NADPH is what's called a mobile electron carrier. Its job is to bring electrons and hydrogens to the stroma, where enzymes use its reducing power to transform carbon dioxide, the third input for the Calvin cycle, into carbohydrate. The light reactions involve two energy transformations. To see these, we need to look at the membrane of the thylakoids. The first transformation is shown here and here, where light energy is initiating an electrical current. Those little E's are electrons flowing along a pathway that's called an electron transport chain. The second transformation takes electricity and transforms it into chemical energy. This happens here as ATP is made and here as NADP plus is reduced to NADPH. Let's start with the transformation of light to electricity. This toy car has a solar cell that can take light energy and make electricity out of it. That electricity then flows to a motor that converts the electricity into kinetic energy, motion. If I block the light, no electricity flows and the motor stops. So what do you need to know about light? Just this. Visible light is made of massless particles called photons that vary by wavelength and energy. Red light has the longest wavelength and the lowest amount of energy of any type of visible light. These wavelengths are really small. The wavelength of red light is 700 nanometers, which is a billionth of a meter. The wavelength of blue light is shorter and its energy is higher. Pigments are substances that absorb certain wavelengths of light and reflect others. Right now, I'm wearing a red shirt. It's red because of pigments that are absorbing blue, yellow, green wavelengths and reflecting red wavelengths back into your eyes. The main pigment in photosynthesis is chlorophyll. There are two forms, and they absorb red and blue light and reflect green light. That's why chlorophyll is green, and that's why leaves are usually green. Like phospholipids, chlorophyll has a head and a tail. The head consists of a nitrogen-rich structure called a porphyrin ring. In the center of that ring is a magnesium atom. The tail is a hydrocarbon chain. Because of this structure, chlorophyll can be stimulated by light. This is called photoexcitation. When light shines upon chlorophyll, the light stimulates the electrons in the magnesium atom to jump to a higher energy level. In the thylakoid membrane, chlorophyll molecules, represented by these green spheres, are organized into what are called photosystems that do what solar cells do. They convert light into electricity. As we'll see again later, the source of the electrons is water. Note that there are two photosystems sequentially linked together. They were numbered in order of their discovery, so photosystem 2, unfortunately, comes first, followed by photosystem 1. You just have to remember that. The pathway by which electrons flow from photosystem 2 to photosystem 1 is called non-cyclic electron flow. Here's how it works. We're zooming in on photosystem 2, which you'll remember is the first photosystem. Photons stimulate chlorophyll molecules that are organized into an array called an antenna complex. A radio antenna captures radio waves, which are very low frequency photons. The antenna complexes in photosystems 2 and 1 capture visible light photons. When a photon hits a chlorophyll in the antenna complex, it stimulates the electrons in that chlorophyll's magnesium atom. Eventually, the stimulated electron gets to what's called a reaction center, a pair of chlorophyll molecules that are called P680, named for the wavelength of light, 680 nanometers, that most strongly stimulates them. In photosystem 2, P680 is positioned so that when its electrons get boosted, they come into the vicinity of what's called a primary electron acceptor. These are molecules that grab boosted electrons away from the chlorophylls in P680, leaving P680 in an oxidized state. After all, it's lost an electron. We'll come back to this oxidized P680 in a moment. For now, let's follow what happens with this boosted electron. It flows along photosystem 2's electron transport chain. This flow makes up an electrical current that's powered by solar energy. Earlier, I showed how electricity from a solar cell can be used to power a motor. In this case, in photosystem 2, the electricity powers tiny proton pumps that pump protons from the stroma to the thylakoid space. The thylakoid space is surrounded by the thylakoid membrane. That's what defines the thylakoid space. The membrane's phospholipid bilayer is not permeable to protons, making it, as far as protons are concerned, a closed compartment. All of these protons packed into that closed compartment represent a form of potential energy. In my video about ATP production in mitochondria, which uses processes that are almost identical, I compared these trapped protons to water trapped behind a dam and discussed how engineers can direct this trapped water through turbines to do the work of generating electricity. In a thylakoid sac, a parallel process occurs. The protons can't diffuse through the phospholipid bilayer of the thylakoid. There is, however, a channel that lets them pass through. This channel is called ATP synthase. It's a channel and also an enzyme, and the reaction that it catalyzes is to take ADP and phosphate and to convert them into ATP. Here, you can see ATP synthase letting protons diffuse through it, using the kinetic energy in these protons to drive forward the reaction of making ADP and phosphate into ATP. And here you see another animation of this same process. The diffusion of protons through ATP synthase to create ATP is called chemiosmosis, a term that refers to the pushing force of diffusing protons. But there's a little bit more to this ATP creation story. Let's return for a moment to P680, which was oxidized when it lost an electron to the primary electron acceptor in photosystem 2. To replace these lost electrons, a water-splitting enzyme complex in photosystem 2 rips electrons away from water, oxidizing it. This causes water to dissociate into two protons and one oxygen atom. The oxygen atom immediately binds with another oxygen atom to form molecular oxygen, O2, which diffuses away. This splitting of water is the source of two things. First of all, the electrons that photosynthesis is based on, and the molecular oxygen that makes up our atmosphere. Think about that the next time you take a breath. And the protons that result from water splitting enhance the proton gradient between the thylakoid space and the stroma, increasing ATP synthesis. Now we've seen how the light reactions take water and light as inputs and use them to create ATP, with oxygen produced as a waste product. There's only one part missing to our story: the production of the mobile electron carrier, NADPH. NADPH production happens at the end of non-cyclic electron flow. Electrons that originated in water have flowed along the electron transport chain of photosystem 2. As they've done so, their energy was used to pump protons from the stroma into the thylakoid space. Now these electrons arrive at photosystem 1. This photosystem also has an antenna complex that can capture light energy and convert it into electricity. In the case of photosystem 1, the reaction center is called P700. At P700, electrons get boosted and then snatched away by a primary electron acceptor, which sends these electrons to another electron transport chain. This leaves the chlorophylls at P700 oxidized. But note that photosystem 1 doesn't have to oxidize water to replace these lost electrons. Rather, they're replaced by electrons flowing in from photosystem 2. These electrons from photosystem 1 flow along a second electron transport chain to an enzyme called NADP plus reductase, which uses these electrons to reduce the mobile electron carrier NADP plus to NADPH. We've now accounted for both of the products of the light reactions. Non-cyclic electron flow is also called the Z scheme. If you took a Z and put it on its side, you get the idea. Electrons rise in energy in photosystem 2, then fall as they go through the electron transport chain of photosystem 2, and then they rise in energy again as they go through photosystem 1. Here's another representation of the Z scheme, and let's use it to summarize the light reactions. Light is captured by photosystems that convert light energy into electrical energy. In photosystem 2, the electrical energy is used to pump protons into the thylakoid space. This creates an electrochemical gradient that's used by the ATP synthase channel to make ATP. In photosystem 1, the electrical energy is used to reduce NADP plus into NADPH. And the source of the electrons for the entire process is water, which gets split apart into protons, which enhances the proton gradient across the thylakoid membrane, and oxygen, which bubbles away as oxygen gas. Head on over to sciencemusicvideos.com, where there's an interactive tutorial about the light reactions waiting for you. And that's how you're really going to come to understand this. Please do a couple of things. Hit that like button, subscribe to my channel, and above all, sign up for a free trial of Science Music Videos, where you can be part of the movement to vanquish biology confusion. I'll see you there. That's why leaves are usually green. Okay, let's try that again.